Recorded Books and One-Click Digital present Fatal Identity by Joanne Fluke. Narrated by Tavia Gilbert. Prologue. He knew he'd lived in a house once, but it hadn't been as big as this mansion in Mandeville Canyon. Although he couldn't remember it, he'd had a mother and a father, and maybe even a dog. The Red Lady had told him that once, when she was having one of her good days. He remembered that day very clearly. It had been the best day of his life. Miss Rizel had given him a box of new pencils for his birthday, with his name stamped on them in gold letters. There were 12 pencils, in pretty, bright colors. 3 orange, 3 green, 3 blue, and 3 yellow. He'd counted them out for Miss Rizel, and she'd said, "Very good, Jimmy." And then she'd hugged him and told him that he was a very good student, the best she'd ever had in kindergarten. The flat box of pencils had rattled under his shirt, and there had been an unaccustomed smile on his face as he'd run all the way back to the apartment building. He'd pulled open the door to the dark, cramped little lobby with its row of broken mailboxes, and his smile had abruptly disappeared. The Red Lady was waiting for him upstairs, and he had to be very careful. He never knew which one she'd be. The one who slept on the rumpled bed in the red room with her mouth slightly open to let out the snores. The one who sat at the table and smiled and told him how much she loved him. Or the one who grabbed him roughly and made him do nasty things with one of the uncles because he was a bad boy who needed to be punished. As he tiptoed up the creaky wooden steps that led to the fourth floor, he put on the mask he wore for her. It was a good mask, and it had saved him from her punishment several times in the past. He wore it so she wouldn't learn how much she hurt him. His eyes were downcast, so she couldn't read his expression and call him a rude little bastard. His head was bowed in an attitude of respect. His expression was carefully blank, like the glass-eyed face of the teddy bear Miss Rizel had on the shelf in their classroom. It was a look of impassive surrender to the things over which he had no control. It was a lot like the reading contests in school. If you could read the word, Miss Rizel let you go out for recess early, but if you missed your word, Miss Rizel gave you another and another until you got one right. It wasn't fair to compare her to Miss Rizel, but he'd learned the whole thing was very similar. If he got the mask right, the Red Lady hit him once or twice and then she gave up and let him go, but if he whimpered or started to cry, she hit him again and again until he was perfectly quiet. When he reached the second floor landing, he stepped around an old drunk sleeping off the effects of the bottle in the brown paper bag he still clutched in his hand. The landing smelled bad, a combination of human waste and breath wheezing past rotten teeth. As he stared up the stairs, they creaked loudly. The drunk woke up and reached out for him, but he was young and fast, and he scrambled up the stairs as fast as he could. There was garbage on the stairs, and he held his breath as he hurried past, flies crawling over something that looked like dog food. The Red Lady had told him that some of the people who lived here ate dog food. It was cheap and it kept them alive. As he came to the top of the stairs, he bent down to pick up a piece of ripped cloth that was caught on the banister. Then he took out his pencil box and stuffed in the cloth so his pencils wouldn't rattle. If the Red Lady was having a bad day, she might break them all, especially if she guessed that he liked them. The first chance he got, he'd hide them under the loose board in the closet. The rats might find them, but that was better than watching her destroy the present Miss Rizel had given him. He stopped and felt his face to make sure his mask was in place. Then he took off the key he wore on a string around his neck and opened the door very cautiously. She was up, sitting at the table, her back to him. Before he could say anything at all, she turned. There was a smile on her face, and she looked almost happy, but he still kept the mask in place. He'd seen her smile turn into a frown in the blink of an eye.
"Happy birthday."
Her smile was still in place.
"Come over here, sweetie. I've got a present for you."
It still wasn't safe, so he approached very quietly in case she was having one of her bad days. But she hugged him and patted the chair next to her.
Open it, sweetie.
She handed him a heavy box wrapped in silver paper with a big blue bow on top.
Uncle Bob picked out this present for you.
He couldn't help it. He started to smile. Uncle Bob was his favorite uncle. He was older than the rest, and when he did the nasty thing in the red bedroom, he was always very gentle. She held out her hand, and he took off the blue ribbon and handed it to her. She liked ribbons, and she kept them. Then he loosened the tape and took off the paper so she could use it again. There was a white box under the paper, and he was almost afraid to open it.
Go ahead, she urged him. Take off the cover.
The lid of the box was taped shut, and he slit the tape with his fingernail so it wouldn't tear. Then he lifted off the cover. His smile spread all the way across his face as he saw what was inside. Books! He turned to her, almost afraid she'd say it was all a mistake and they weren't for him. But she just smiled.
Uncle Bob thought you'd like them. They must be pretty old because he said he read them all when he was a boy, and Uncle Bob's no spring chicken. Now listen to me, sweetie. You keep these books right here on the table. I want Uncle Bob to see you reading them.
He nodded. I will. I promise.
All right, then.
She smiled and opened one of the books. Her eyebrows lifted, and she started to frown as she handed him the open book.
These words are hard. Can you read them?
Sure. The moment he said it, he knew he'd made a big mistake, especially since she'd dropped out of school in the sixth grade and she'd never learned to read very well. Now there was a frown on her face.
Oh yeah, Mr. Smarty Pants? You'd better watch it because I'm starting to see red.
He looked up at her with a worried frown on his face. He had to eat his words fast, or she'd start having a bad day and punish him.
These really are big words.
He looked properly contrite.
Could I ask Uncle Bob if I don't know some? That way he'll know I'm reading his books.
It took her a minute, and then she clapped her hands and smiled again.
You're a smart little boy. Every time Uncle Bob is here, you ask him about a word. He used to be a teacher, you know. If he thinks he's helping you, he'll come to see us more often, and that'll mean more money for us.
Okay.
He nodded.
Shall I pick out a word right now?
She shook her head.
No hurry. Uncle Bob isn't coming back until later, and then we're gonna have us a little party. Now open this.
He tore his eyes away from the box of wonderful books and took the small envelope she handed him.
What is it?
It came with you, and I saved it for you. I think it belonged to your mother.
His hands were shaking as he opened the envelope. Inside was a picture of a young woman, all dressed up in a long white dress. She had a halo of beautiful blonde hair around her face, and her lips were curved up in a gentle smile. She was standing in front of a white house with green trim around the windows, and she was holding a bouquet of flowers. There was a dog at her feet, a small dog with a happy face, and he could see the shadow of the man taking the picture. His father?
Is that her?
His breath caught in a painful sob. She looked like an angel, and he wished she were here right now. His mother looked kind and sweet, almost like Miss Roselle, except much prettier. She shrugged.
I guess so. I told you it came with you, so it's gotta be her. I bet you think she's pretty, huh?
Something in the way she said it made the hair on the back of his neck bristle a warning. Careful. He had to be very careful. A line from a cop show he'd seen on Miss Gladys's television flew through his mind. Anything you say can and will be used against you.
Her hair's white.
He looked down at the picture again.
Was she real old?
That made her laugh, and he breathed a sigh of relief. He'd done the right thing. He didn't know why, but she was jealous of that picture.
No, she's young. Her hair's just bleached out real white. And see those flowers she's carrying? That must have been her wedding picture. And you see the shadow in front of her?
He looked down at the picture again and nodded.
I see it.
It's a man's shadow, so maybe it's your father. Somebody had to take the picture, right?
He nodded and did his best to look impressed.
That's right. I never thought of that.
I'd make a pretty good detective, huh?
She grinned at him as he nodded.
I think that was their house. You can almost make out the name on the mailbox. It's kind of fuzzy, but their last name starts with a B and it's got 7 letters, just like yours.
This time, he really was impressed.
You know a lot, Aunt Niecy. I wish I could be as smart as you.
A quick smile spread over her face, and for just a moment she looked almost pretty. She reached out to ruffle his hair, and he was careful not to flinch. This was a good day, not a bad day, and he wanted to keep it that way.
Okay, so now you've got the picture. And don't go asking me questions. All I know is they found you in a basket in front of the place, and that picture was tucked inside your blanket. Now, why don't you...
She stopped suddenly and reached in her pocket to pull out a flat, tissue-wrapped packet.
I almost forgot. Here's my present. It's old, but I can't afford to buy you new.
Thank you, Aunt Niecy.
He took the packet and unfolded the tissue paper. Inside was a thick silver chain. Why would she give him a silver chain? His mind sifted through the possibilities, but he couldn't come up with a thing.
Well?
She was frowning slightly, and he put on a delighted smile.
Wow, it's wonderful, Aunt Niecy.
You bet it is.
She smiled.
Old Roy gave that to me when we got married. Of course, you don't remember your Uncle Roy, do you? He died when you were just a baby.
I think I remember him.
The truth was, he didn't remember Uncle Roy at all, but he said what she wanted to hear. According to her, Uncle Roy had been a saint, and since he'd lost a leg in a train accident, they'd had his disability check every month. When Uncle Roy died, the checks had stopped coming and she'd sold everything to pay the bills. That was when they'd gone on welfare and moved to this old apartment building.
You can keep your key on that chain.
She smiled at him.
Then you can't lose it. Now you go pick out a couple of big words and write them down, so you can ask Uncle Bob. He's bringing chink food for our party. And after we eat, you'll make him feel real good about that present he gave you, won't you?
He nodded. It was what she expected, and it wouldn't do any good to tell her that he didn't want to do the nasty thing in the red bedroom anymore.
You like to help me with the uncles, don't you, sweetie?
He'd nodded again because he'd learned that it was the smart choice. If he told her that he hated what the uncles did to him, she'd beat him. And then she'd tie him to the bed in the red room so Uncle Bob could do it anyway. But if he wore the mask and agreed with everything she said, he could avoid the beating. Of course, there was no way to prevent what the uncles did to him. It was a part of his life, like breathing.
I'm going out for a pack of smokes.
She picked up her purse and headed for the door.
You stay right here, and don't you make any noise. You hear?
The moment she was gone, he picked up one of the books and started to read. It was all about two boys who lived in an orphanage. Orphanage was a good word to ask Uncle Bob. It was 9 letters long, and no one would expect him to know it. There was a smile on his face as his eyes skimmed the words following the story. These books were old, but they were still good. He would be able to live in a wonderful storybook world for as long as they lasted. And then he could start reading them all over again. It was very good of Uncle Bob to give him these books. Now he'd have something interesting to think about when he was alone in the red bedroom with the uncles. He came back to the present with a jolt as he heard the glass door to the patio slide open. He parted some of the dense leaves in the hedge bordering the side of the pool and peered out anxiously. It was only the housekeeper. She had a broom in her hand, and she was going to sweep off the patio as she did every night. He liked the housekeeper. She was always friendly, and she took good care of the children. She thought she knew him, but all she really knew was the mask. They thought they were locking him out with the new security system, but he could get inside the gates anytime he wished. And they'd never guessed that most of the time he was here already. It was like the Red Lady used to say, there was always a way around everything if you used your head. Of course, she wasn't saying anything now. Now, her mouth was closed forever. He could feel the red mist threaten as he thought of that night, and he pushed it away. Not now. He had to be alert. The housekeeper was sweeping back and forth with hard, even strokes of the broom. It reminded him of something that made him shiver, but he pushed that out of his mind, too. He felt the hair on the back of his neck prickle as a voice called out from the house. Not one of her children, and not the husband either. This was a different voice, a voice that made him ache inside with its hauntingly familiar tone. And then he saw her, and his breath caught in his throat. She was wearing a white bathing suit, and she looked like a swan, all sleek and glossy and graceful. Or perhaps she was an angel. Her beauty was pure and immaculate. He felt his hands begin to tremble uncontrollably as she stepped into the light by the pool. She was going to swim, and he loved to watch her swim. The warm feeling rushed through him as she slipped into the water. Oh, how beautiful. How lovely her arms were as they rose up and down in the water, stark white columns of curving beauty that cut through the dark surface to emerge again for the next stroke. Her long, shapely neck arched out of the water, and her glorious blonde hair gleamed in the moonlight, even though she'd piled it high on her head in a shining knot. She was supple and strong like a young sapling, but as delicate as a piece of fine lace. She was Homer's Helen of Troy, and Poe's Lenore, and Sir Lancelot's Lady of the Lake. She was the only woman he had ever loved. She was Jimmy's lost mother, and he wouldn't let her leave him again. But there was something wrong. A hateful red color spilling out from the garden just beyond the pool. Red blossoms like the blood that had bubbled and bloomed from Aunt Niecy's mouth. He had to stop it before it spilled out and covered him. The red mist began to swirl around his feet, rising, rising. He had to move quickly before it was too late. He stepped out very softly, very quietly, to do what had to be done. Around the pool, behind the hedge of lush green boxwoods, without a rustle. Like a cat in the dead of night, he moved without hesitation. And then he dropped to his knees on the soft earth by the bubbling blossoms. And he whimpered as he plucked them off one by one, crushing the petals between his fingers and feeling them die. Her head turned in his direction. It seemed as if she were looking directly at him with her beautiful green eyes. But he knew that was only an illusion. She saw only a shadow, heard only a faint rustle. A neighbor's cat in the garden, a fierce night prowler stalking his blood prey. Her head rose out of the water, watching, listening. But he was as still as death. And then she began to swim again, her fears laid to rest. As well they should be. He was here, and he would always protect her from the red. Tears fell from his eyes like warm spring rain. How he loved her. He had broken the rule to warn her, broken his vow of silence. He had chosen the words to tell her, cut them out of paper, and pasted them to the letter he'd sent to her. Red is the color of blood. He knew he had frightened her, and he was ashamed. But his words had done their work, and she had been wise enough to listen. She had changed her hateful red bedroom to a sea-green place of beautiful peace. The red mist was rising now, rising up to claim him. In a few moments, it would reach his mind, and then there would be a merciful darkness. But there was work to be done before he could rest. He dropped to the ground, shredding the petals into thin strips that blew away in the winter wind. They would shrivel and fade, buffeted by the air until they turned to a harmless brown. Earth, air, fire, and water. They were the ancient elements. They had the power to destroy the red, to send it away forever. At last he was finished, and he smiled as he got to his feet. It was his job to keep her safe. He was her guardian, her lover, her unseen protector. Only he knew how to save her from the certain destruction of the red. Chapter 1. Even though she'd had a grueling day, Mercedes Calder flashed the driver one of her famous million-watt smiles as he helped her out of the studio limo. Her smile was totally genuine. Mercedes liked the new driver the studio had assigned to her. George never tried to make idle conversation on the 20-minute trip to the studio when she had lines to learn. He didn't mind stopping at the school to pick up her twins on the days she finished shooting early, and he was unfailingly prompt. Even though George was well paid by the studio, Mercedes planned to give him a generous bonus when they wrapped her film. 6:30 tomorrow morning, George. I have an early call.
No problem, Miss Calder. I'll be here. Do you want me to check out the house for you?
Mercedes shook her head. That's not necessary, George. They finally finished installing the security system, but thanks for asking. That was very thoughtful. George tipped his hat and slid back in behind the wheel. He was a retired policeman who looked like a fullback, over 6 feet tall, with the muscular body and lightning reflexes of a professional athlete. He'd told Mercedes he'd taken his early retirement option when he'd been shot chasing down a murder suspect. He'd known they were planning to kick him upstairs, and he hadn't liked the idea of sitting behind a desk all day. Early retirement pay wasn't all that much, and George had done private detective work for a year or two. Then he'd landed this job with the studio as a combination bodyguard and driver. Although the studio had dismissed Mercedes's threatening letters as a crazy prank by an unstable fan, they'd immediately assigned George to be her driver. And it had worked, as far as Mercedes was concerned. She never worried when George was around. He was more than capable of defending her, and when she was with him, she felt safe. At least there hadn't been any threatening letters today. Mercedes had checked the mailbox at the end of the driveway when they'd stopped at the gates. She hoped that her ordeal was over, that her crazy fan was locked up tight in some mental hospital or jail. Mercedes still shivered when she thought about the letters that had come in the mail. The words had been cut out of magazines and pasted on pieces of plain notebook paper. The whole thing had sounded like something you'd see in a bad B-movie, but the message had been chilling. Most stars got an occasional letter from a crazy fan. It was so common, it was almost normal. Ashley Thorpe, her co-star in Summer Heat, had told Mercedes about the proposal he'd received from a 70-year-old widow who'd offered her life savings if he'd spend the night with her. And Sandra Shepherd, the character actress who played her mother in the movie, had mentioned a letter she'd received last year from a high school student in Iowa inviting her to be his date for the senior prom. Mercedes had been in the biz for over 15 years, and she'd shrugged off plenty of proposals and propositions from crazy fans before. But the letters she'd received 2 months ago were very different. They'd come to her home instead of the studio. The first letter had arrived on a Saturday, and Mercedes had been alone in the house. She'd been out at the pool, enjoying the warm rays of the sun, when she'd heard the distinctive squeaking brakes of the mailman's Jeep. Since she usually got a letter from Marcie on Saturdays, she'd hopped into her car and driven down the long, winding driveway to pick up the mail. Marcie's letter was there, and Mercedes had taken the time to read it. Then she'd noticed another letter marked personal, with no return address, and she'd opened that as well. "I am watching you. I will always be near. Do not try to hide. You can keep nothing from me. I am with you at night when you swim in the pool. I am with you when you go to bed in the red room. Please do not sleep in the red room. Red is the color of blood. The others will tell you lies about me, but I am not what they say. Do not try to escape me. I will not let you leave me again. You will be with me always, even in death. Jimmy." Mercedes's hands had been shaking as she'd finished reading the letter. He knew her bedroom was red. He really was watching her. She jumped back into her car, locked all the doors, and peered out of the window in fright. The grounds seemed peaceful enough, but was he out there somewhere, taking vicious pleasure in her fear? Her instinct had been to race for the house, but she'd left it unlocked, and he could be waiting for her inside. Pure panic had propelled her as she turned on the ignition and put her car in gear. She had to get away. But where should she go? What should she do? She'd made a quick U-turn, tires sliding on the gravel, and headed down Mandeville Canyon Road. She'd glanced nervously in the rearview mirror, but no one had seemed to be following her. She was safe. For now. As she turned on Sunset Boulevard, she'd suddenly remembered the interview she'd done for a popular fan magazine. It had mentioned her exercise regime, 20 laps in the pool every night, and there had been several photos of her in her newly redecorated bedroom. If he'd seen a copy of that article, he would have known about the swimming and the color scheme of her bedroom. Perhaps he wasn't watching her after all. With each mile Mercedes traveled away from the house, she'd felt a little calmer. She knew that most people who wrote threatening letters never dreamed of actually carrying out their threats. This man was probably nothing more than a harmless neurotic who got his kicks by scaring people. Still, it couldn't hurt to take a few precautions, like buying a handgun and learning how to use it. And while she was at it, she'd order a new security system. The one she had was over 10 years old. It turned out that buying a handgun in California was a frustrating experience. Although her life had been threatened and she had a legitimate reason for wanting to arm herself, there was still a mandatory waiting period before she could take her new Ladysmith revolver home. Rules were rules in California, where the anti-gun lobby was strong. Crooks could buy guns immediately through illegal means, but honest citizens had to wait and hope that they'd still be alive at the end of the waiting period. Mercedes had walked away from the gun store, shaking her head. She was probably overreacting, but she had to take precautions just in case. She'd stopped at a payphone to call a home security service, and she'd hired an armed guard to patrol the grounds until her new state-of-the-art security system was installed. Then she'd arranged to have her room redecorated in a lovely shade of sea green. That would please Brad. Green was his favorite color. Brad hadn't liked her red bedroom. He'd said it was like sleeping inside a catsup bottle. She'd laughed at his joke, but she'd been planning on changing the color scheme anyway. That night, when Brad had come home and found the security guard, he told her he thought she'd done exactly the right thing. The letter was scary. And while it was true that Mercedes probably wouldn't hear from this particular man again, she was a big star and there were lots of crazy fans out there. Then he'd hugged her and told her he wished he could always be home to protect her. Unfortunately, his investment business demanded a lot of traveling. He'd certainly rest much easier after the new security system was installed. It would give him peace of mind, knowing that Mercedes and the twins were safe behind locked gates. The second threatening letter had arrived a week later. Luckily, the security guard was on duty when Mercedes had taken it out of the envelope, and she hadn't panicked. Her crazy fan was still out there, but at least she now knew what he wanted. I am still with you, watching and waiting. No one can protect you. You must do exactly as I say. Give your husband $20,000 in a backpack. Tell him to go to the phone booth on the corner of Sunset and Gower at noon tomorrow. I will call him and tell him where to leave the money. I love you. You belong to me. I have no wish to cause you pain. Jimmy. When Brad had read the letter, he'd urged her to call the police. Naturally, Mercedes had refused. The police could do nothing, and there were bound to be leaks to the press. The studio wouldn't like that kind of publicity, and this whole thing was probably just a crazy prank. Exactly a week later, the third letter had arrived. It was almost identical to the second, except that the sum of money had doubled, and there was one additional postscript after the signature. Your security guard cannot protect you. If you continue to ignore me, perhaps your death will not be as merciful as I planned. When Brad read the letter, he was convinced that they had to take action. While he agreed that he didn't believe in giving way to threats, he'd suggested that perhaps they should pretend to do what the crazy fan wanted. He'd go to the phone booth, get the instructions, and deliver the money, and then he'd stake out the area and catch the nutcase when he came to pick it up. Mercedes had vetoed that idea immediately. There was no way she'd let him do something that dangerous. But Brad was insistent. He was her husband, and he wanted to protect her. There was no way he'd let a crazy fan get away with threatening his wife. They'd argued about it long into the night, but Mercedes had been firm. She wouldn't let Brad put himself in danger, and she wouldn't even pretend to give way to blackmail. Brad knew how blackmail worked. If the crazy fan actually succeeded in getting the money, he'd keep right on sending threatening letters, demanding more and more cash. It was best to take a strong stand in the beginning and not give in to this type of extortion. Even though Mercedes had shrugged off the threats, she was concerned enough to take the letters with her to the studio the next morning. The studio hired experts to deal with crank letters from crazy fans, and Mercedes had asked their advice. They'd agreed that she had done all the right things to protect herself. They'd said not to worry, that they'd dealt with hundreds of extortion letters, and nothing had ever happened. It would have been an entirely different matter if someone had come up to her face to face and made these kinds of demands, but no one had, and chances were her crazy fan was already back in a mental institution or a jail cell. Mercedes felt much better after she'd talked to the studio experts, especially since they'd assigned George to be her driver. George was armed, and he was formidable. There was no way anyone would bother her while she was under his protection. After she'd finished work for the day, Mercedes had asked George to drive her to the gun store. She'd picked up her revolver and bought a gun safe that only opened if she pressed a series of coded buttons. George had installed it for her, and that weekend he'd driven her to a firearms safety class, where she'd learned how to use her ladysmith with deadly accuracy. Of course, Mercedes hadn't mentioned any of this to Brad, and she'd decided not to tell him if she got another threatening letter. Brad might do something brave and foolish, like trying to catch the blackmailer himself. The letters had definitely changed Mercedes's life. Opening the mail had always been fun for her, but now she dreaded it. She held her breath every time she picked up the neat stack of letters her postman slipped in the box. It had been almost a month since the last threatening letter, and she was almost convinced that her crazy fan had given up. But even though their new security system was up and running, George had told her to carry her revolver from room to room whenever she was alone in the house.
"Are you sure you're all right, Miss Calder?"
George looked concerned, and Mercedes nodded. "I'm fine. See you in the morning, George." Mercedes waved as the limo drove off. The moment the gates had opened and closed again, she reactivated the alarm system. There was no way anyone could open the gates without the code. And if anyone tried to climb over the bars or force his way in, a patrol of armed security guards would be on the grounds in less than 5 minutes. The alarm on the front door was set, and Mercedes punched in the code on the numbered panel. The advisor from the security company had cautioned her against using her birthday as a code. That was a matter of public record. Brad had suggested they use their anniversary instead, and he joked that it was one way to make sure she never forgot the date. As if she could. As she opened the door and walked across the tile foyer, Mercedes caught sight of her reflection in the gold-framed oval mirror on the wall. She'd never considered herself beautiful, although everyone else seemed to think she was. Green-eyed blondes weren't all that unusual in her home state of Minnesota. When Mercedes had landed her first movie role, the studio publicity department had called her a cross between Doris Day and Marilyn Monroe. The comparison had made Mercedes laugh. Doris had been bubbly and innocent, while Marilyn had exuded sex from every pore. Mercedes knew she wasn't bubbly and innocent, or super sexy. She was just an ordinary actress who worked hard to learn to play any role she was offered. At first, Mercedes had played the fun-loving teenager, the cheerleader who fell in love with a quarterback on the football team. Then she'd graduated to college roles, playing the young freshman co-ed who fell in love with a professor. From there, she'd played the young professional who fell in love with her boss. She was always falling in love and ending up happy, the essence of the female romantic lead. Finally, she was mature enough to play other, more demanding parts, but her latest role in Summer Heat was the biggest challenge she'd ever faced. Summer Heat was a story of deception, of a marriage gone awry. Mercedes played the victim, a wife whose husband was slowly poisoning her so that he could be free to marry his mistress. She had to be naively trusting and totally unsuspecting in the early part of the movie, a woman who was so in love with her new husband that she was completely blind to his faults. As the movie progressed, her character deepened and matured. The wife began to doubt her husband and finally realized in horror that he was trying to kill her. At the end, Mercedes had to play a woman so crazed by her husband's duplicity, she exacted a terrible revenge. Her role in Summer Heat wouldn't have been all that difficult if it had been a play. Most plays were chronological, starting at the beginning and progressing in a straight line to their conclusion. But movies weren't like plays, although most people who weren't in the industry didn't realize that. Almost all of Mercedes's scenes were shot out of sequence. The scene they'd done today had been near the end of the movie. Mercedes had played the vengeful wife, preparing to kill her husband and his mistress. Tomorrow, they would shoot the park wedding at the very beginning of the movie, and that meant Mercedes had to jump back in time to play the trusting bride, meeting her husband's mistress for the first time and being completely unaware of their relationship. It took mental preparation to jump back and forth like that, but it was more cost-effective. Scenes that took place in the same setting were shot on the same day, regardless of where they occurred in the movie. Mercedes reread the script every night, starting at the beginning and stopping at the scene they'd shoot the next day. That helped her to get into the right frame of mind for the morning's work. "Rosa? I'm home." Mercedes walked down the hall and peeked into the immaculately clean kitchen. Her housekeeper wasn't there. She walked through the beautifully decorated rooms on the ground floor, but Rosa and the children were nowhere to be found. Since she was still uneasy when she was alone in the house, Mercedes got her Lady Smith from the gun safe and carried it upstairs to her pretty sea-green bedroom, where she undressed and slipped into a robe. She loved the new color she'd picked for her bedroom. It was very calming and restful. Then she sat down at her white wicker dressing table and peered into the mirror to assess the damage after her long day of shooting. There were tiny lines at the corners of her eyes, but that wasn't surprising. She'd waited up for Brad to come home last night, despite her early call. Her green eyes were clear and bright, thanks to the eye drops her makeup artist had applied, but her pale blonde hair was wet with perspiration. Mercedes walked to the huge mirrored bathroom and turned on the shower. She'd feel much better once she washed her hair and used some conditioner. She took off her robe and surveyed her body critically. Her skin was still tight, and her breasts were high and firm with no signs of sagging. Another week of dieting, and she'd be in better shape than she'd ever been in before. And she needed to be in perfect shape, since she would wear a bikini in the honeymoon beach scene. As she stepped under the hot stream of water, Mercedes gave a weary sigh. She really didn't feel like swimming laps tonight, but she knew she should. Physical fitness and a proper diet had kept her looking like she was in her 20s when she was actually 34. When Mercedes emerged from the shower, 15 minutes later, she felt refreshed. She changed to a warm-up suit that had been especially designed for her. Then she towel-dried her hair. The ends were beginning to split from having it blow-dried too often, and carried her Ladysmith downstairs with her. Perhaps she was being a little too paranoid since the new security system was armed, but it did make her feel much safer. Her first stop was the den, where she poured herself a glass of perfectly chilled Chardonnay from her husband's new wine cooler. Brad was a wine connoisseur, and he had over 200 labels in his temperature-controlled Euro cave. At least this hobby of his was useful, not like the racehorses that never won, or the antique cars that were stored in their specially designed warehouse garage. The wine was delicious, a light, fruity vintage, and Mercedes smiled. 110 calories. She'd have to skimp on dinner, but it was worth it. Then she flopped down in the leather massage chair behind her husband's desk and called the florist to order flowers for her hairdresser, who had just given birth to her first baby. After 5 minutes in the massage chair, Mercedes felt rejuvenated. She took another sip of wine, picked up the phone again, and called the number for her voicemail. The first message was from Brad. He wouldn't be home until late. There were harness races at the track tonight, and he wanted to check out some of their competition. By the time she got this message, he'd be at the stables with their horse trainer. Metro Golden Mare was having some problems, and they might have to scratch her in Sunday's race. Mercedes frowned and tapped her pen on the message pad. Thoroughbreds were an expensive investment, and they weren't paying off. She'd wanted Brad to minimize their losses and sell out, but he'd convinced her to hang on for one more season. And now their prize racehorse was going to be scratched. When she'd married Brad 2 years ago, she'd thought that he was a shrewd businessman. But instead of increasing her capital, he'd reduced it considerably. It was a very good thing she'd met with Sam Abrams, her lawyer, on the set today. She knew Brad would be upset at first. But he'd understand when she explained exactly why she'd hired another investment firm to handle the bulk of her assets. If he continued to funnel her money into risky ventures, there'd be nothing left for her twins. When Mercedes pressed the button for her next message, her hand was shaking. She took another sip of wine and got ready for more bad news. But this message was from her housekeeper, and Rosa always made her smile. Rosamunda Sechene Koshut was a welcome addition to the family. Mercedes knew she'd always be grateful to her first husband for hiring Rosa to help out when the twins were born. When Rosa had first come to work for them, there had been a language problem. Rosa spoke perfect English, but she had just emigrated from Hungary. Her accent was so thick, Mercedes had been unable to understand her. They'd solved the problem by calling in a friend who made his living as a dialogue coach. After 2 months of speech lessons 3 times a week, Rosa's accent had faded to only a faint trace. Rosa had given Mercedes a worry-free decade. Mercedes's children were her children, and Rosa was a supermom. The twins would be 10 years old next week, and Mercedes had planned a big party. What Rosa didn't know was that the twins had a surprise for her. Mercedes had taken Trish and Rick to an expensive jewelry store, and they'd picked out a beautiful watch to give to Rosa. Mercedes had assured them that Rosa would love it. Of course, Rosa would love anything her babies gave her. Rosa's room was decorated in what Mercedes called early twin, with crayon drawings, framed finger paint handprints, and dried flowers they'd picked for her in the garden. Mercedes laughed as she played Rosa's message. She could hear the twins in the background, urging her to please hurry. Rosa had left a message to say that she was taking the kids to an early movie and they'd stop for a hamburger on the way home. Mr. Brad had insisted the kids needed a night out, and he'd given her money to spend. She'd prepared a chicken salad for Mercedes. It was in the refrigerator, along with a big pitcher of iced tea. Mercedes sighed. Salad, again. A thinly sliced, skinless chicken breast on a bed of mixed greens with diet dressing. 350 boring calories, but she had to lose another 4 pounds before they shot the bikini scene. 34 was a rotten age for an actress. It was too old to play the ingenue and too young for mature woman roles. There weren't many parts written for actresses in their mid-30s, and the competition was fierce. Her best hope for continued success was to stay in perfect shape. Even though she tried not to think of it, Mercedes pictured Rosa and the twins in a green leather booth at Hamburger Hamlet, munching on thick, juicy burgers with crispy French fries. The twins would talk Rosa into ordering huge slices of chocolate cake with fudge sauce and ice cream for dessert. They always did. And Mercedes was stuck here with chicken salad. Of course, she couldn't have gone along, even if they'd waited for her to get home. She had script changes to memorize before tomorrow morning, and she couldn't afford to blow her diet. Mercedes swallowed, her mouth was watering, and punched the button for her next message. It was a polite reminder from her dry cleaners asking her to pay her last month's bill. She jotted down the information on a yellow sticky and placed it on the top of Brad's desk. Since she was so busy with her career, Brad handled the bills for all of their household expenses. The fourth message was also about an overdue bill, the landscaping service this time. Mercedes wrote out another yellow sticky and placed it next to the first. Brad had mentioned that they were having a slight cash flow problem, but this was ridiculous. Perhaps he just hadn't gotten around to writing the checks yet. The next message was a typical call from her sister. "This is your twin sister, Marcie Calder, in Minnesota." Mercedes put the message on pause and laughed out loud. She only had one twin sister, and she knew where Marcie lived. But Marcie was shy, and she felt so uncomfortable about leaving a recorded message that she always identified herself that way. "I called to tell you that Cousin Betty is getting married on Saturday. She's Aunt Bernice and Uncle Al's youngest daughter, the one who used to wet the bed when they came to visit. I'm not going. It's way up in Hibbing, and they're predicting snow for the weekend, but I'm sending a gift. I called to ask whether you want me to include your name on the card." Mercedes frowned. She vaguely remembered their cousin Betty and knew that anything that Marcie picked out would be fine. Her sister was an art teacher, and she'd always had impeccable taste. "I bought a beautiful pottery bowl at the college art sale. Cerulean blue with pink and lavender blossoms that remind me of the ones in Cézanne's vase of flowers. It was $54, which is a lot, but since it was the last day, the artist took $10 off. If I don't hear from you by tomorrow, I'll just add your name to the card and send it off." Mercedes grinned. Thank goodness one of them was organized. She remembered receiving Betty's wedding invitation last week, but she'd tossed it aside and forgotten all about it. How could twin sisters be so different? They looked alike, tall, with blonde hair, green eyes, and light complexions. If they dressed alike, no one would be able to tell them apart. But they had totally different temperaments. Marcie was solid, dependable, and sweetly naive, while Mercedes was exactly the opposite. The only thing they had in common was their disappointing luck with men. Mercedes had married Mike Lang, the producer of her first picture, right after the film was completed. It was a May-December marriage. Mike was 30 years her senior, but both of them had wanted children. Mercedes had gotten pregnant almost immediately and delivered twin babies, a boy and a girl. They'd named them Patrick and Patricia, and they'd called them Rick and Trish. Both Mercedes and Mike had been delighted with their happy, healthy babies. But Mike had been a workaholic, and the stress of producing hit after hit had taken its toll. He died of a massive heart attack when the twins were only 2 years old. At first, Mercedes had thought she'd never love again. Then she'd hired Brad James as her investment counselor, and everything had changed. She'd married him at the high point of their whirlwind Hollywood courtship, and she was beginning to wonder if the old adage was true. She'd married in haste, and she worried that she might repent in leisure. It seemed as if all the romance had gone out of their marriage. Brad was gone more often than he was home, and although she had no proof, she suspected that he was involved with someone else. Marcie had suffered through a bout with a fickle lover, too. She'd fallen in love with a fellow art student when she was in college. Mercedes had met him. He was handsome and very talented, but she had been worried that he was only using Marcie until someone else came along. As it turned out, she'd been right. The day after their graduation ceremony, Marcie's boyfriend had flown off to France with a wealthy widow, leaving Marcie with nothing but a note and a couple of his paintings. "Oh, yes, I got the round-trip airplane ticket, and I'll be there for the twins' birthday party. I can't believe they're 10 years old already. But really, Marcie, I absolutely insist on reimbursing you. It makes me feel like a charity case when you pay for everything." Mercedes grinned. Marcie was the only person who used her nickname. The Calder twins had been Mercie and Marcie all through high school, and Mercedes had hated it. Every time she'd complained, Marcie had told her she ought to be grateful their parents hadn't named them something even worse. They'd compiled a long list of names that made them shudder, names like Patrice and Caprice, Mabel and Sable, Clarissa and Marissa, Edwina and Bettina, and the very worst, the one that had made them collapse in gales of laughter, Drusilla and Ludmilla. "Guess I don't have any other news. Curtis Benson spilled green poster paint all over the 10 leather shoes you gave me, but it came right out with a little saddle soap. Give the twins a kiss for me, and keep one for yourself. Bye." Mercedes was still grinning as she wrote another yellow sticky for Brad, telling him to send Marcie a check for $22, her half of the wedding gift. A call from Marcie always cheered her up, and having her here for the birthday party would be wonderful. The last message made Mercedes frown. Her agent and business manager, Jerry Palmer, wanted to discuss her next project over lunch tomorrow. But there wouldn't be a next project for Jerry. She'd already talked to someone else, and she was planning to switch to them right after summer heat was completed. When she'd broken the news to Brad last night, they'd had a nasty fight. Jerry was Brad's friend, and she'd hired him on Brad's recommendation. They'd argued for hours, but finally Brad had agreed that she needed to go with someone who had more clout with the big boys. And that brought up another problem, one she needed to solve immediately. Mercedes picked up the telephone and called Sam Abrams. He'd been her lawyer for almost a dozen years, and he was practically a member of the family. That gave her certain privileges other clients didn't enjoy, such as access to his home telephone number. It took only a moment to make sure that all her future earnings would go directly to Sam's office, and Mercedes was smiling as she hung up. By this time, it was almost 7 in the evening, and she was beginning to think much more kindly of Rosa's chicken salad. She'd swim 20 laps, treat herself to another glass of wine, and eat in the poolside cabana. Since she'd already lost a total of 10 pounds, none of her old bathing suits fit her new svelte figure. She'd ordered more, 12 lovely white suits that had been especially designed for her, but when she opened the drawer in the cabana, she found that the designer had made them in the wrong color. There were 12 new suits, but all of them were red. Mercedes frowned as she remembered a line from the first threatening letter. Red is the color of blood. Her fingers trembled as she held up the suit, but she forced herself to remain calm. The crazy fan was long gone, and even if he wasn't gone, there was no way he could get past the sophisticated security system. She took another sip of wine to fortify herself and slipped into the red bathing suit. She wasn't about to give up her exercise regime because some loony objected to the color of her bathing suit. There was a sound, and Mercedes froze. It sounded like the security gates were opening. Were they home already? She waited a moment, expecting to hear Rosa's car, but there was no crunch of tires on the crushed rock driveway. It took no more than a second for Mercedes to pick up her revolver. The solid weight of the tempered steel was comforting, and she held it tightly as she listened for any other alarming sounds. But everything was perfectly quiet. Since her security system was new, and she wasn't quite used to relying on it, it took Mercedes a moment to remember to check the closed-circuit monitor. There was one in every room, including the cabana. When she switched it on, the camera showed that the gates were firmly closed. The sound she'd heard must have come from the pool equipment, or perhaps her neighbor's gate had opened. Sound sometimes carried quite far in the canyon. Mercedes felt a little prickle of fear as she stepped out of the cabana. Of course, there was no reason to be nervous. Her security system was armed. If anyone tried to get into the house, bells would clang, sirens would blare, and the police would be notified immediately. She was perfectly safe from any intruder. She put her Ladysmith down at the side of the pool and tested the water with her toe. The pool was warm, just the way she liked it, and Mercedes slid into the water. She'd learned to swim at an early age, like most kids who grew up in Minnesota. The land of 10,000 lakes had several within biking distance, and Mercedes and Marcie had spent practically the whole summer in the water. But the swimming season was short in Minnesota, barely 2 months long. Mercedes was glad she lived in California, where she could use the pool year-round. Mercedes used the Australian crawl for her first two laps. She was an excellent swimmer, and when they were teenagers, both she and Marcie had qualified as Red Cross certified lifesavers. When she'd moved to California, she'd actually taken a job as a lifeguard at Santa Monica Beach. It had paid for her acting lessons and given her a great opportunity to get a tan. Then Mike had discovered her, and her dream had come true. She'd gone from her one-room ramshackle apartment in Venice to this gorgeous 20-room mansion in Mandeville Canyon. She pushed off at the deep end and swam another lap, using the butterfly stroke. It was physically exhausting, lifting herself out of the water with her arms, and Mercedes was puffing by the time she finished. Time to change to something less rigorous, like the breaststroke. Two laps of that, and she switched to the side stroke for another three laps. Freestyle was next, and Mercedes alternated between her favorite strokes for five more laps. She was getting tired, but she was pleased at all the calories she must be burning. She chose a modified crawl for her last six laps. A total of 20 laps was a lot, but she knew she could do it. The end was in sight, only one lap to go. Mercedes was running on pure determination when she approached the deep end of the pool. She looked up and gasped as she saw a dark shape behind the palm tree by the diving board. Suddenly, the pool lights went out, and she was plunged into darkness. Mercedes opened her mouth to scream, but it ended in a sputter as strong arms pushed her head beneath the surface of the water. She kicked out desperately, trying to propel herself away, but her tired legs found only the slippery resistance of the water. There was nothing to kick, nothing to push, and her head was held under the water in a grasp of steel. Her tortured mind screamed out for air. Her lungs were burning as her muscles began to spasm. She struggled to pry loose, but her frantically clawing fingers encountered padded gloves. It was no use. Her mouth and lungs were filling with deadly water. The last thing Mercedes Calder saw in the cold blue moonlight before final blackness closed in was the wavering image of her killer's familiar face above the surface of the water. Chapter 2. It was 7:15 in the morning when Marcie Calder stepped out of her apartment and prepared to perform the Minnesota footwear switch. She carried her shoes in a plastic shopping bag looped over her arm and wore her boots. She needed boots to wade through the snow to the garage at the back of her building. Once inside, she would slip out of her boots and switch to her shoes to back the car out of the garage. Then she'd put on her boots again to get out and close the garage door. And then she'd switch back to her shoes for the drive to school because her snow boots were too bulky for driving. This was only part of the reason why Marcie never wore shoes that tied in the winter. The Minnesota footwear switch still had several more steps. After parking her car in the faculty parking lot, she'd switch to her boots for the icy trek to the front entrance of the building. Once she was inside, she'd switch back to her shoes and carry her boots to the rug in the closet of her classroom. This was Marcie's winter morning ritual. When school was dismissed for the day, she had to do the same thing in reverse until she was back in her apartment again. Marcie sighed. Winter in Minnesota was exhausting. Just getting to work could be an ordeal. With her heavy wool coat, scarf, gloves, ski sweater, and moon boots, she carried around at least 20 extra pounds all winter long. No wonder every Minnesotan was delighted when spring finally rolled around. It was like finding a crash diet that worked overnight. As Marcie walked down the carpeted hallway of her apartment building, she tried not to clump in her heavy boots. Her next-door neighbor worked the late shift at Franklin Manufacturing, and she didn't want to wake him. The Langers in 103 were already up. Marcie could smell bacon frying, and she wondered how Bonnie Langer got the energy to cook breakfast every morning. She worked two jobs, and so did her husband, Tom. They were newlyweds, and they'd told her they were saving up to buy a house. As Marcie passed the end apartment, she heard Sue Ellen Dubinsky's baby crying. But no more than a second later, the crying abruptly ceased. Sue Ellen must have popped a bottle in his mouth. This was Sue Ellen's sixth baby, and she told Marcie that motherhood was easy once you got the hang of it. She could heat a bottle, feed the baby, and get the older kids off to school without ever really waking up. Marcie opened the door at the end of the hallway and went down three steps and across a small landing to the back door. Double doors were practically a necessity in Minnesota to keep out the winter cold. There was a small window in the back door, and Marcie lifted the curtain to peer out at the world outside. It was dark. The sun wouldn't rise for another half hour, and the lights in the yard were still on. Icy snow pelted against the thermal window pane, and Marcie shivered. It had snowed all night, and the winds were blowing even harder this morning. She was glad she lived only 3.5 miles from technical high school. Marcie turned up the collar of her coat and tugged her red stocking cap down over her ears. Then she pulled on her gloves and opened the heavy back door of her apartment building. A blast of frigid wind almost knocked her off her feet as she struggled down the walkway to the garage. There was an outdoor thermometer mounted on the trunk of the elm tree, but Marcie didn't bother to look at the temperature. It was so cold, her breath came out in white, puffy clouds, and she knew the mercury would be huddled down near the base of the thermometer, too sluggish to peek out above zero. The door to her one-car garage stall was stuck, and Marcie had to give several hard yanks on the handle to free it. The metal door creaked as it rose upward, protesting the bitter weather. The space inside seemed slightly warmer, but perhaps it was only cold because she was out of the wind. Marcie opened the door to her old VW Beetle and performed the first switch of the day, from boots to shoes. The old bug started on the first try. It was a great car for the winters in Minnesota, heavy enough to plow through snowdrifts and very stable on the icy roads. She backed carefully out of the garage and groaned when she heard something snap. She'd forgotten to unplug the dipstick heater again. Marcie opened the driver's door, switched to her boots, and got out to examine the heavy-duty electrical cord. She was lucky. The plug had pulled cleanly out of the socket, and the cord was still intact. She wrapped it around the bumper and pulled down the garage door. Then she switched to her shoes for the second time, turned on her windshield wipers to do battle with the blowing snow, and drove down the icy alley to the street. Her radio was tuned to KCLD, a local St. Cloud station, and Marcie sighed as she listened to the weather report. Another 2 inches of snow predicted, accompanied by winds from the northeast at 15 to 20 miles an hour. The temperature was expected to drop to minus 16, a record low for this state. The announcer sounded much too cheerful as he reminded the good folks out there in KCLD land that if you added in the wind chill factor, the total would be a frigid 37 degrees below zero. Marcie shivered and turned her heater on high. The Valentine's dance was scheduled for tonight, and she was one of the faculty chaperones. It wouldn't be canceled. Minnesotans knew how to take bad weather in their stride, but the kids would be required to drive on the buddy system. Cars would team up, and if one driver got into trouble, the other would pick up the stranded passengers. Minnesota teenagers knew how lethal the freezing cold could be. With a wind chill factor of 37 below, no one would take any foolish chances. As Marcie turned onto the 10th Street Bridge, she mentally reviewed the contents of her trunk. She had a 20-pound bag of kitty litter for ballast, an extra can of gasoline, a spare windshield scraper, 2 wool blankets, an old army parka she'd picked up at a yard sale, and a pair of fur-lined gloves. There was also an empty 3-pound coffee can, which contained a candle and a pouch of waterproof matches, an effective way to warm the interior of a stalled car until help arrived. It was a standard Minnesota survival kit that wise motorists carried throughout the winter. All those items definitely took up space, but the trunk wasn't used for much else in the winter months. If groceries were loaded into the trunk, soda cans would freeze and pop open, plastic milk cartons would expand and shatter, and a head of lettuce would shrivel up and turn as brown as a walnut.
"This tragedy just in on our newswire."
The announcer no longer sounded cheerful.
"Local authorities have just recovered the body of a university co-ed who attempted to walk home from a party shortly after midnight last night. Preliminary medical reports indicate that her left ankle was broken in several places, and she was apparently unable to crawl for help. Her name will be released, pending notification of relatives in Arizona."
Marcie pumped her brakes lightly and slowed to a careful stop as the light on Fifth Avenue changed from green to yellow. Even though visitors from other states were cautioned about the severity of Minnesota winters, some of them disregarded those warnings. Just last winter, a businessman from Texas had suffered extreme frostbite while jogging in shorts in the early morning cold. There were times when the temperature was very deceiving, especially when there was no wind. On a still, sunny day, 15 below zero might feel almost the same as 15 above, but there was a huge 30-degree difference. Any carelessly exposed patch of skin could be flash frozen in seconds. "Oh, for heaven's sakes!" Marcie spotted a familiar figure walking gingerly down a rut in the road and rolled down her window.
"Donna Hunsiger, where are your boots?"
"I left them in my locker, Miss Calder."
Donna looked very sheepish, and Marcie did her best not to laugh. Donna's mother would have had a coronary if she'd known her daughter was walking to school in tennis shoes.
"Climb in, Donna. I'll give you a ride."
"Gee, thanks, Miss Calder."
Donna slushed her way to the passenger door and got into the car.
"I've got another pair of shoes in my locker, honest. These are my old ones."
"Don't worry, Donna, I won't squeal on you. Put your feet up by the heat vent."
Marcie showed her where and pulled out into the street again.
"You got a ride home with Dennis yesterday, and it wasn't snowing then. You completely forgot you left your boots in your locker until you got ready for school this morning."
"That's right. But how did you know?"
Marcie laughed. "I did the same thing when I was in high school, but my sister saved me."
"Is that your famous sister, Miss Calder?"
"That's right."
Marcie noticed the rapt expression on Donna's face, and she knew her story would be all over school by the end of first period.
"Mercedes said I could use her boots if I pulled her to school on the sled.
Gee, Miss Calder, Mercedes sure was smart.
Marcie nodded and pulled over to the curb to let Donna out at the entrance of the school. As she drove around to the faculty parking lot, she laughed out loud. Mercedes had been smart, much smarter than Marcie had realized at the time. Not only had she gotten a sled ride to school, she'd also made Marcie promise to do the dishes for a month. By the time fourth period rolled around, Marcie was exhausted. Mr. Metcalf, the principal, had asked Marcie's art classes to decorate the school gymnasium for the dance. Her first period sophomore class had spent the entire hour making giant poster board cutouts of hearts and cupids and sticking them up on the walls. The freshmen in second period had strung ropes of red and white streamers to form a canopy over the dance floor, and her third period juniors had set up the tables and decorated them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.